Good morning. It is the 10th of December 2021. Welcome to the seventh lecture in Letters Boltzmann Methods. Today we are talking about practical things that you also need for your project, initial and boundary conditions. So, starting off with the rescaling of numerical units, then we come to initial conditions. We talk about equilibrium, initial conditions and boundary conditions. We talk about non-equilibrium corrections. This is kind of an advanced topic. Then a standard Lattice-Boltzmann boundary condition is the bounce back rule. And then we come to interpolated bounce back rules, which are important for geometrically complex boundaries. Okay, we start off with the scaling of units. So this is important in Lattice-Boltzmann because we have, of course, a grid spacing delta x, which is something given in meter, in the units of meter, and we have a time step delta t, and this is something in seconds. So the physical quantities that we want to simulate, they are somehow related to these physical units, of course, and now we have to put them into units that are suitable for the Lattice-Boltzmann method. So in other numerical methods, it may be possible to just simply simulate in terms of physical units, which, by the way, you should never do, because physical units in may be very inappropriate from the point of view of round-off errors to be used in numerical methods. So you should always ask yourself what is the best scaling of your variables in order to keep numerical errors low. And in Lattice-Boltzmann, and the time step and the grid spacing are always regarded as one in the units used in the Lattice-Boltzmann method. Therefore, we require a scaling a I'll say a mapping from physical units, or from, sorry, my dyslexia. So from physical quantities, like the ones that we want to set, like the velocity. And we'll call the physical quantities now with this asterisk. We have a physical velocity u, and we have a physical pressure p. We are also write an asterisk. And they have to be mapped to lattice units, to a lattice velocity, which for simplicity I write without the asterisk, and a lattice density actually, rho. So in Lattice-Boltzmann, pressure is related to the density. Okay, so the important thing to keep in mind is that in the LBM algorithm, So when you run the code, or in LBM units, say, you see, I have a new computer, bit complicated now, in LBM units that are used in the algorithm, we always assume that delta t is equal to 1 and delta x is also equal to 1. So we have to scale something in terms of meters and seconds to this non-dimensional units. So all values have to be scaled to lattice units in order to run the simulation. And later, of course, after running the simulation, all the lattice units have to be scaled back to the physical units. So let's start with the lattice velocity. Lattice velocity as an example, pretty simple. So we have u will now be u asterisk times delta t by delta x. Yeah. So this is useful both for your boundary conditions and for your initial condition. So just in case this is not completely obvious, I just show an example. So suppose your crit spacing delta x is 1 millimeter and your time step would be 1 microsecond. So you have to decide this before, right? So then your so you want to set a boundary condition, which I write now in a scalar. Boundary or initial condition is 1 meter, 0.1 meter per second. So how to translate this to lattice units? Well, this would be 0.1 meters per second times 10 by the power of minus 6 seconds. So this is 1 microsecond divided by 10 by the power of minus 3 meters, which is 1 millimeter. And this gives you 10 by the power of minus 4. Yeah, so there are no units anymore. So this is what you have to specify to your boundary or initial conditions. If you have this crit spacing, delta x is 1 millimeter, delta t is 1 microsecond, and you want to set a velocity of 0.1 meters per second. So this was pretty easy. The lattice pressure is a bit more involved. And this, of course, has to do with the fact that we do not set the pressure directly, but we rather set the density, and this is connected by an equation of state. Yeah, so I write pressure is expressed in terms of density. In LBM, and this is subject to the equation of state that we are using here. And this equation of state is that P, the pressure, is equal to the speed of sound squared, Cs, times the density that we write as rho. Okay, so in the Navier-Stokes equation, we usually do not use an absolute pressure. And the reason for this is that the that only pressure differences, so only a gradient in pressure, appears in the Navier-Stokes equation, and the absolute pressure is not necessary in the Navier-Stokes equation. In Lattice-Boltzmann, this is different. In Lattice-Boltzmann, the absolute pressure is also important. So note that the absolute pressure does not appear in the Navier-Stokes equation. And only a relative pressure How do I write pressure? Okay, so this applies to the Navier-Stokes equation. In Lattice-Boltzmann, we have the density, and the density, of course, is not only a relative density, but is also needs an absolute part. Now, fortunately, since the equation of state is linear, so due to the linearity, of the equation of state, we can use a base pressure and a base density. So we can do it like this. So we have the physical pressure that we want to specify divided by the base pressure. So this would be a constant. This P0 would be a constant. And they have to be, their ratio has to be equal to the density that I specify divided by base density. So, and this base density is customary to set this base density to 1. So there's no particular reason to do this, but this is what is usually done. So this rho 0, we simply say this is 1. And this means that the density that we have to set would, in Lattice-Boltzmann, would just be the pressure that we wanted to specify divided by the base pressure, the physical base pressure. And this rho zero, this is of course a constant, it is 1, could be something else, but it would always be a constant. And since it is a constant, it is in the asymptotic analysis is the zero order, part of the expanded density. Okay, with pressure we have to be a little bit more careful. So I'll give an example. Let's have an example. So suppose we have a tube, yeah, and across the tube we want to specify a pressure drop, yeah. So this is our tube. So there will be a pressure drop, and this pressure drop, of course, implies that there is a P, 2, say, and there is a P1 on the other side. But the absolute pressure doesn't play any role in the Navier-Stokes equation. So what is usually given as an boundary or initial condition would be this delta P, and let's say this would be 100 Pascal, just to give it a number. I should use my other pen. So now what is the base pressure? So say we are in air, then the base pressure is the background pressure, and this would be um, 1000 hectopascal, so it would be 10 by the power of 5 pascals. And what we have to do in Lattice-Boltzmann now, where we have to set this rho 2 and this rho 1, so we cannot simply set the density to zero. If we set the density to zero, we will divide by zero when we compute the velocity. So we have to take this base pressure into account. And because we said that the base pressure is equal to 1 in Lattice-Boltzmann, we specify that at the outlet, this rho 2 would be set to rho 0, and this would be set to 1. So that according to this above, the rho 1, which is the inflow divided by rho 2, which we set, of course, or actually rho 0, which of course we've already set to, if some technical problems here, rho 0, this is the delta pressure plus the zero pressure in physical units divided by the zero pressure, I mean the base pressure, and this will give you basically 1.001 in this case. So in Lattice-Boltzmann, if you want to set the pressure boundary to zero, if Navier-Stokes guys tell you you have to set the velocity pressure, the pressure boundary somewhere to zero, you are actually setting it to one, and the other boundary you set to one plus the difference in the pressure. Okay, this is how it works. And now this leads us to actually the initial conditions. And we'll call initial, I will always write initial conditions as IC. So there's one important thing to recognize, namely that we need initial conditions for all moments. Whereas in the Navier-Stokes equation, they require initial conditions only for the velocity and the pressure. So we have to specify initial conditions that do not exist in the Navier-Stokes equation. Yeah. So we somehow have to choose them. And the easiest way to choose these moments is to use the so-called equilibrium bound, the equilibrium initialization. So we have an equilibrium method. And this is pretty simple. So given the velocity at the position x and at time step 0, at position x and at time step 0, and given rho at the position x and time step 0, what we simply do from this information, we compute the local equilibrium the same way we do it in the collision. So we do this for each lattice node. From the Maxwell distribution or the Maxwell moments. And then we initialize the distributions. Okay, so what is the good thing? The good thing is this is simple. The next good thing is it actually works, and this is what most people really do in practice. What is the bad thing? The bad thing is that the second moments are wrong. They are wrong if the initial condition has a velocity gradient. And this will lead to the wrong dissipation in the initial phase of the simulation. So now it really depends, because sometimes this is very important and sometimes it is not important at all. So if you really want to see how your flow behaves right after you start it, so you set a specific complicated case, so you have two vortices colliding, yeah, and you specify this velocity field, and you want to see how this behaves from this original condition, initial condition onwards, then this is a problem. Sometimes you're only interested in the long time behavior, and then it may be sufficient to initialize your model with an inconsistent boundary condition, because even if you start from inconsistent boundary condition, yeah, the long time behavior will still be correct. So this is why often, even if we know that it is incorrect, we still initialize with this incorrect method, because it's the simplest way to do it. If this is not sufficient, we can do something else, namely we can do a second moment correction, second moment non-equilibrium correction. By initializing the non-equilibrium part of the second moment. So this is necessary because the Navier-Stokes limit requires second order moments to be second order accurate in our smallness parameter epsilon and third order moments, they have to be accurate to first order. So, and remembering what we did last time, the asymptotic analysis of the moments and let's look in two dimensions at the moments or the second order moments m20 to second order, m02 to second order and m11 to second order. So this is in two dimensions, they are all the present second order moments and they look like this, m20 to second order is equal to m20 equilibrium to second order. So this is what we would set by putting there the equilibrium initial conditions, but to second order m20 has also a non-equilibrium part that looks like this, 1 over omega minus 1/2 into the derivative of u dxu plus 1/3 dy we want. So this is of course already for the usual D2Q9 Lattice-Boltzmann method with standard equilibrium. Okay, and this also multiplied by rho to the zero order. So m02 second order is m02 equilibrium to second order minus 1 over omega minus 1/2 dx, forgot, 1/3 dx u 1 plus dy v 1, and this into rho 0 order, and then we have m11. M11 second order is M11 equilibrium to second order minus 1 over omega minus 1/2 and this into 1/3 dx now V1 plus dy U1 into rho 0. So actually we also have the condition that the first order divergence of the velocity also has to vanish. So the third order guys, they are simple because they are just equivalent, So they only have to be known to first order, and to first order they are known to be just their equilibrium value. So there's no problem with them. We can just use equilibrium method for them. This is rho 0 and V 1, which means that equilibrium is sufficient for third order moments in the initialization. However, it is not sufficient for the initialization of second order moments, as we just said. So the initial conditions of second order moments they must be set, and of course they have to be set in pre-collision state. So this M bar is that comes out of the this M bar here, that comes out of the asymptotic analysis, is the mean between the pre-collision and the post-collision. Yeah, pre-collision plus post-collision and 1/2 of this. In the initial conditions, we of course have to set the pre-collision state, and the pre-collision state is when we do the transformation, we get the following. So M20, this is the pre-collision state. This is still M20 equilibrium, and I write everything now without order, because this is what we are simply going to set. So here, instead of 1 over omega minus 1/2 in pre-collision, this is just 1 over omega, and this into dxu plus 1/3 dy v. So this we have to specify, and for M02, it would be M02 equilibrium minus 1 over omega rho here, then 1/3 dxu plus dy v, and for M11, we would have M11 equilibrium minus 1/2 1 over omega rho 1/3 dx v plus 1/3 dy u. Okay, so this was the initial condition. And now we come to the second part, the boundary condition. So boundary conditions, which I'll call BC. So, and here we have the same problem as with the initial conditions, because in the Navier-Stokes equation, we have velocity and pressure, and here we have to set the entire distribution. So this means, again, that the Navier-Stokes boundary conditions cannot be imposed directly. because we have to impose the distributions and not velocity and pressure. So, and there are in principle two ways, two approaches, boundaries can be specified in Lazarus-Boltzmann, and one of them is the node-based boundaries and the other one is the link-based boundaries. And we start with the node-based boundaries. So, and for this, we return to our beloved diagram, space and time diagram. So these are lattice nodes. Say we have a wall here, and we have space here, and we have time here. So this is one dimension in space and in time. So, and now we look at boundaries and at the distributions. And I will specify incoming distributions, so incoming from above. Yeah, so these are the distributions going into a node, and then there are distributions going out of a node. So then I'll call this here is post-collision, and the other one is pre-collision. So at the boundary node, we have an incoming distribution. This is the blue one. And we, of course, we have this outgoing distributions. So the pre-collision distribution should give the, so post-collision, we always write with this asterisk, and the pre-collision we write without asterisk. So what we also do is that we'll now write this Fi as the one that is going into the wall, and F minus I that is going out of the wall. And this here, this is the position at the wall, XW. So the distribution going into the wall, into this node, this is known. However, the distribution that is coming out, the post-collision state here going in the other direction, yeah, this is unknown. Now there are in principle two things that you can do. So two approaches. The first thing is you can specify the entire distribution. The entire population at a node. And if you replace the entire population as the node, you can simply proceed as with the initial condition. Yeah. So this is, you know, the velocity, you know the pressure that you want to set. So you simply put, you simply compute the equilibrium, or maybe also the non-equilibrium. You compute this and you specify this as this particular node and fill everything up. However, you also see that part of your distribution is known because you have an incoming distribution from now the left-hand side. And this enables you to actually use this information. And this would mean you replace only the missing distribution. So the missing link, so to speak. So the missing populations. So this would be, in this case, this would be F1. Yeah? So we could also, instead of Fi, we could also write F, because it's actually going in the right direction. So it's F1 going outward and F-1 going inward. And F1, this F1 is known. So we could use this F1 because it is known and only replace the distribution that is not known. So the first thing is relatively simple. If you replace everything, you don't need to care about what is coming in. If you replace only the ones that are missing, then you heavily depend on the orientation of the wall, yeah, because we are usually not in, in this one-dimensional setup, but we have potentially complex walls, and with complex walls we, for example, have corners, and there we have a different number of missing distributions. So this depends heavily on the orientation of the boundary. Okay, so there is one example of such a boundary condition. So there are many, but one that is pretty classical and well known is the one that is due to Su and He. I believe it's pronounced. It's not he, it's her something. Okay, Chinese, please correct me. And this specified for the D2Q9 lattice. So we see this is quite aged. Yeah, 1996, and it looks like this. Okay, now I'm going to draw this D2Q9 lattice, and in that particular case I assume that now the wall is on the left hand side, which means that distributions going to the left, they are known, and distributions going to the right are missing. Yeah, and these distributions that are going to the right, this is F11, F10, and F1-1. And these are the missing distributions where everything else is known. So, and then we have a collision on this node, yeah? And of course, when we have a collision on this node, we need the entire distribution. And so it's important that before collision, these guys are unknown. This is why they are also specified in pre-collision state, F11, F10, and F10. They are unknown. However, because this is a boundary, we have to we specify the velocity and the density. So velocity and density. And now you recognize the following. We have three missing distributions in this case, and we have two components of velocity and one component of density. Yeah? So we have, and these things are known. This is known. So we have three unknowns and we have three knowns to fill them. So actually, we should be able to specify this. And this leads us now to our equation 7.1, where we say that u is the x velocity, u times rho is the x momentum. This should be the sum over inj ifij. So this is how we compute the velocity. And this is F11 plus F10 plus F1 minus 1. And I put this in brackets because this is the guys that we are looking for. Minus F minus 1 minus 1 minus F minus 10 minus F minus 11. So this is number 1. Then we have 7.2. Where we specify the y velocity, v times rho is, of course, equal to ij jfij. And this is f11 minus f1 minus 1. So these are, again, the guys that are not known, plus f minus 1, 1 plus f0, 1 minus f minus 1, minus 1 minus f0, minus 1. Okay, and then we have the third one, that is 7.3. Yeah, this is just the density, and the density is, of course, fij, the sum of fij. And this again is f1 minus 1 plus f10 plus f11 plus f minus 1 minus 1 plus f minus 10 plus f minus 11 plus f01 plus f0 minus 1 plus, oops, plus F00. So, unfortunately, if we look very hard on this, at this, we see that we have a problem. Yeah, I just said we have three equations and three unknowns. However, these things are not independent of each other, as you see, because we have the same thing here that we have here. So these two equations are not independent of each other. And there is therefore a consistency requirement. So we need a consistency between 7.1 and 7.3. Which we can evaluate by solving for these two things and equating them. And this gives us that we have rho minus F11 minus 1, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, and plus F minus 1, 0, plus F minus 1, 1, plus F 0, 1 plus f 0 minus 1 plus f 0, 0 is equal to u rho. U rho plus f minus 1 minus 1 plus f minus 1 0 plus f minus 1 1. Okay, so this is now the only equation that we have together with equation 7.2. Yeah, so these two we have to solve. Say this is now the equation 1 and this is the equation 2. So we have missing information, and this missing information is filled by an assumption . So usually in this kind of boundary conditions, we have to make some assumptions, and the assumption that we make is that f01 minus f10 equilibrium, so this is basically the non-equilibrium part of the one going to the right, is equal to the non-equilibrium part of the same thing going to the left. And this is then equation 3, and what we do is that we solve 1, 2, 3 for f11, f1 minus 1, and f10, and then we have the pre-collision state from which we can further our from which on we can do the collision and proceed with the simulation. So for this boundary condition, unfortunately I have no pros, I only have cons. So the first cons is that this is of course difficult to generalize to other orientations and also to other lattices. For example, if we have a corner, we have even more missing. We have even more missing distributions. So for example, for corners, Ladestand ist niedrig. Okay, so I'm very sorry, I have to make one update here. How did this happen? Ladeadapter anschließen. Das Stift ist niedrig. Sorry. Okay, I just recognize this is the first time I'm using this. Okay, I hope. Okay, so this is difficult to generalize to corners. And you have more problems. Sorry, this is the first time I'm using this computer. I hope okay. Sorry for this. Yeah, the next thing here is this boundary condition is very unstable. And I really have to stress this. So this boundary condition actually is not used in practice. Am I actually sorry, I have to do. What's the problem? Yeah, I don't know what the problem is. It doesn't work. Okay, I briefly. Okay, so I hope you can see me again. Yeah. Okay, sorry for this. This is the first time I'm using this computer. I was hoping that this doesn't happen. Okay, why are we talking about this boundary condition if it's actually not a good boundary condition? This boundary condition is popular in textbooks because it does something that's kind of intuitive, but not in practice. And because it's so prevalent in textbooks, I actually think I have to talk about this because once you look in a textbook, yeah, you will come across this and you may think, okay, so this is how it's done. However, in practice, you notice people using this kind of boundary conditions, they do not know a lot about Lattice-Boltzmann methods. Yeah, because they're using a method that is very, very unstable. Oh, you can't see the page. What happened yet again? Right. So now you should see the page. I don't know why it just disappeared again. Oh my God. New hardware. Okay, so usually if I see somebody using her boundary conditions, I know that I don't need to read the rest of the paper. Just as a warning. Okay, now we come to the other possibility, the link-based boundary conditions. So these are actually boundary conditions that are in use. Link-based BCs. And the important thing to know is that the boundary condition is now not positioned at the node as it was before, but it is halfway between nodes. Okay, what do I mean by this? Let's again look at our space-time diagram. Yeah, say, so this would be inside. So our wall would be kind of like here. Is this getting on my nerves? So this is X and this is T again. And what we now observe is that we have these guys going this way, and we have distributions coming back here. So we position the boundary. The boundary is now here. And we do not specify the distributions on the nodes, but we just specify the distribution on the link. So what we have given is this Fi that is here coming in, and what we are looking is for is this F minus I that is coming out. And the easiest boundary condition that we can actually impose is to say that this distribution that is coming in is the same as the one that is going out. And this is something that we call halfway bounce back. It's like a mirror image. The mirror, the outgoing distribution, in flight. So these nodes outside, we never have them, and we say that Fi at the position x, so say this here is xn, then xn and t plus delta t, so the next time step. This is simply the one that has been going out. This is Fi. Going out means it's the post-collision state. Xn from the same node at the previous time step. So what does this mean? This means we mirror this distribution. So, and if we mirror this distribution, it means that the velocity, yeah, so the velocity at this position has to be zero, because everything that's going out is also coming in. So their first moments, they will vanish. And this gives us a velocity zero boundary condition. Yeah, so this is very useful, because this is something that we can use for implementing solid walls. And this is then the no slip BC. This means that velocity in all directions zero. Right, so this means that UBC is equal to zero. This is what this boundary condition does. So there are several variations of this. The most important variation is the delayed bounce back The delayed bounce back looks like this. I should actually draw this in a little bit larger, I believe. So these would be the virtual nodes. Here would be the boundary. And I need more time steps. So say we have a distribution that goes out like this. So this is now Fi post F from the point of view of this node here, which we call xn. Of course, this is again x, and this is of course again t. So this actually goes into the wall and then returns from the wall like this, f the inverse, and this we write then as f I x n of t plus now 2 delta t is equal of to f I asterisk x n t. So this appears to be the particle. Yeah, from a physical point of view, you would say this is strange because the particle goes into the wall. It's not reflected on the wall as it would be in the case of the usual bounce back. So in the usual bounce back, it will go to the wall, will be reflected at the wall, and returns right away. And here it goes into the wall and comes out of the wall. So why is this done? This is done this way because I'm not going into details of this because this is relatively complicated, but this guy is often observed to be much more stable than the previous one. So this is more stable than normal bounce back. And it, my computer is not so stable today. And is not terribly different with regards to the time step, because if we are in diffusive scaling, this plus delta t or plus 2 delta t doesn't make a big difference. I will say something about this in a minute. Okay, so there's one generalization of the velocity of the bounce back method, and this is velocity bounce back. Velocity bounce back. So this is something useful if we want to set a velocity boundary condition, and this is a generalization of bounce back for velocity other than zero. And this simply looks like this, that we have f I xn t plus delta t More technical problems than I expected with this new computer today. So this is the post-collision in the outgoing direction, Fi, Xn, and T. And here, of course, could also be a 2 delta T on the other side. Doesn't matter that much. And at this bound, at this boundary, we add a velocity together with our with the prefactor for the different distributions. So this is theta minus 1 and the weights wi ei times the velocity at the boundary. Yeah, and this theta, which we already had, this is the dimensionless temperature, so this is 3, and wi, these are the lattice weights. Okay, so this here will specify a given velocity. So if you set this velocity to 0, you end up with the previous, with the usual bounce back, and the usual bounce back gives you velocity 0, of course. Okay, two more things. How can I get rid of this? So this these boundary conditions that we had until now, both the Suhe and the bounce back boundary condition, they would either put the boundary on the node or halfway in between the nodes. Yeah, and since we are on a Cartesian grid, this means that we cannot put the boundaries where we want to have them. So in usually in finite element methods, you would have an unstructured grid, and in an unstructured grid, you can put the boundary wherever you want them. Here we have a Cartesian grid. So how do we put boundaries where we need them, and not just in this Lego format? So we are asking for so-called off lattice boundary conditions, and this means so we are looking for ways out of Lego land, because at the moment we are in Lego land, because we can put boundaries only at the node or halfway in between the nodes. And what we are going to do is we are using interpolated bounce back methods. So interpolation, bounce back, and I guess the first one was the one of Busidi, and this was in 2001. And what he introduced the subgrid distance. Subgrid distance Q. And Q is the fraction of the vector Fi into delta X between the last grid node and the wall. So you see that Q is obviously between 0 and 1. So, and what Busidi did is he distinguished between two cases. Namely q smaller than 1/2 and q larger or equal than 1/2. Okay, let's look at both of them. Say so this here is q smaller than 1/2 because this distance q delta x is smaller than 1/2 delta x, yeah. And oops, not right. Okay, I try to find out how I get rid of this stupid thing here. Okay, so the way this proceeds is the following. He actually does a bounce back, but if you do a bounce back, so if you start backwards, say, if you start backwards doing a bounce back, you will come to this position. So this is where things come from, and if they do a bounce back here, so if the distribution is mirrored in this place, it would actually come originally from here. So if it comes from originally from here, what we are going to do is a linear interpolation. Linear interpolation to this position here of the distributions that go this way. So we need information from a neighboring node. And this will be reflected in this position, and here it comes to where we want to have it. So we'll write this Fi. So this is Fi, this is the one. F minus I, this is the incoming distribution. This is written as xn and t plus delta t is by means of this linear interpolation is 2q f I the post collision at this position here t plus 1 minus 2q f I asterisk post collision, and this goes into so this is the position, the node at the neighboring node and t. Okay, so this is the case for q smaller than 1/2. Okay, then we have the case. I actually was going to draw this next to it. Putting it here. So say we have the wall now here, so q is larger than 1/2. Then the situation is a bit different. Namely, if we start now from here with the distribution, so this is again, of course, x, this is t, yeah. So we have a distribution that comes out here, is reflected at this position, and will end up here. So it will not reach the node that it is supposed to reach. So what we then do is to use the distribution at, not at this place, but at this place, and we interpolate, could rather write it this way here, so because it's incoming, more accurate representation, so we have incoming here and incoming here, and we do a linear interpolation at the receiving part. So this here is delta x delta delta x q. This is larger than 1/2 delta x. So at the receiving part, we do an interpolation and receive this interpolated distribution, which now looks like this. Q larger or equal than 1/2 is then f I x n, and t is equal to 1/2 q f I asterisk x n t plus 2q minus 1 by 2q f I x I and t. Okay, 8 minutes. this is really funny with this computer. Okay. So the disadvantage of this computer is that it's unusable. What shall I do? Really? Okay, so the disadvantage of this particular boundary condition is that we need information from the neighboring node. Yeah, so this information from the neighboring node is not necessarily available, and therefore people thought about boundary condition interpolation methods that need information only from one node, and these things are called one point interpolation. Bounce back. And let's see whether we manage to get this through. In this 5 minutes. So suppose this is my setup where this again here is Q delta X, and now it does not matter whether it's larger or smaller than 1/2. Here we have again time, and here again we have space. So, and now instead of interpolating in space, we are going to interpolate along the characteristic. A characteristic is this line that we draw in space and time. So this here basically is a characteristic. And we can also interpolate along these characteristic lines. So what we are going to do is a linear interpolation along a characteristic line which means we interpolate to this position here in space and in time. But first of all, yeah, we have to know what is on the wall. So let's say this here is xn, the position xn, this here is xb in the bulk, and this here is xv for virtual, and this here is x boundary condition. Okay, so the first thing is we have to get actually to the wall, and interpolating along this line leads us to the distribution at this wall. This will be fi, so going into the wall, x at the boundary condition, and because this is an interpolation along a characteristic, it will go from t to t plus q delta t, so it's not a full time step, but only the flight time that is required to get there, t times q plus fi, so this is x, the virtual node, and time step later, and this into 1 minus q. So now the important thing is that the pre-collision state at this virtual node in t plus delta t, this is equal to the post-collision state at xn and t, which is important because we want to have the information all on this particular node. So this allows us to write fi x at the boundary condition t plus q delta t is equal to fi xn t times q plus fi post collision xn, so at the same position and even at the same time, but it's now the post collision state, 1 minus q. Then we do a bounce back at the wall, bounce back on the wall. Bounce back just means we are reflecting, so f in the other direction, so f minus is at the time t plus q delta t is equal to fi xn and t times q plus f in the other direction post collision state xn times an xn and t times 1 minus q. So I'm going to finish this now. So if what we need to know is fi at the position xn, yeah, and this we get from interpolation between f at the position of the bulk, so this is the bulk, t plus delta t and the one at the wall, Fi boundary condition, T plus Q delta T. And this gives us an Fi xxn. And here we have to take now again the time into consideration. So I write this now out because I'm a little bit short in time. Actually, we are over time already because of technical problems. So this gets to Fi at x, the bulk node, so the one to the left, T plus delta T into Q. So this is the linear interpolation between the two, Q divided by Q plus 1, because the complete distance is Q plus 1, and we have Fi x boundary condition T plus Q delta T 1 over Q plus 1. And this is Fi Fi at the Fi x in the bulk T plus delta T is of course equal to the post-collision state at the position xn and t. So we can write all of this together, Fi xn and t plus 2q delta t divided by q plus 1 is equal to Fi asterisk xn and t q by q plus 1 Fi plus Fi xn and t q by q plus 1 plus Fi asterisk xn and t 1 minus q plus 1. So, and now, since we are in diffusive scaling, delta t is proportional to epsilon square errors in time are not important. And 2q by q plus 1 delta t can be assumed to be delta t, and therefore we have our new boundary condition, our new link-based boundary condition as xn t plus delta t is equal to Fi asterisk xn and t q by q plus 1 plus Fi xn t q plus 1 plus Fi asterisk xn and t 1 minus q by q plus 1. So this uses information only from one node and still specifies the boundary condition somewhere in between the node. Okay. So thank you for attending. Yeah. And see you in 1 week. Sorry for the technical problems.